So it's been about a week since the 14-inch M1 Pro MacBooks were released, and I have to say it's been a pretty interesting and exciting week. Now, the theme of this particular video is going to be about portable power, because at the end of the day, that is the main function of a laptop. It's all about balancing three things: power, portability, and battery life. And with that in mind, let's begin. So starting off with connectivity, as you guys have already seen from my videos, we do get MagSafe back, which is great. It has also received a few updates as well. You've got the slimmer MagSafe connector. The cable has been upgraded to a braided cable, which seems much stronger. And some of you guys might remember the old school MagSafe cables. They were quite brittle and sometimes they would bend or snap right at where the charger connected to the MacBook. So with this new cable, it seems a lot more robust. We've also got HDMI 2.0 and the SD card reader. And this is so good because I actually don't need to bring a dongle or a hub with me when I go traveling or when I leave home. For example, now I've got HDMI, I've got SD card. I really don't need to bring anything with me. And some people have complained about the lack of a USB-A port on the MacBook. I don't agree with this because most people these days, most of their accessories are USB-C. Guys, the USB-A connector just really needs to hurry up and die and just be completely phased out. But worst case scenario, you can get a little mini dongle that you can convert to a USB-A to USB-C very, very easily and very, very cheaply. One other thing that's great to see back is Thunderbolt ports on both sides. If you guys remember with the previous M1 2020 MacBooks, you only had Thunderbolt ports on the left side. Now you've got them on both, and you can actually charge this device from both sides, which is just such a good thing to have back. Now, moving on to the notch, which is a really controversial topic. Guys, I honestly don't mind it, and I usually don't even notice it, especially if you're using dark mode or a dark wallpaper, or your apps are in full screen, for example. And at the end of the day, you do gain more screen real estate with the notch. Obviously, you can move that menu bar up towards the top of the screen. Yes, Apple probably could have fit the webcam into the top bezel and eliminated the need for the notch. But at the end of the day, again, remember that you're getting a 1080p webcam, which is better than most other laptops out there. And I think Apple's also going for a uniform look between its devices. Obviously, we have the iPhones with the notch, now the MacBook. So I think it's almost like the new trademark for Apple devices in a sense. Now, moving on to performance, this thing is blazing fast. Now, maybe not a super big upgrade from the M1 MacBook Pro, even though this certainly does outperform that previous machine. The M1 MacBook Pro is just an awesome bang for buck. Even the Air, if you don't need that fan and increased battery life. I did make a video comparing this to the 2020 M1 MacBook Pro, if you're interested. But that being said, you do get a pretty significant performance bump with this machine. But the most impressive thing is you get a lot of new features over the 2020 M1 MacBooks. Especially if you're a video editor and you use Final Cut Pro, those dedicated video encoders and decoders really do make a difference, especially if you use ProRes and Final Cut Pro, so much so that I've actually decided to switch my entire video workflow over to ProRes because of these new MacBooks. This essentially means I can ditch my huge RTX 3080 editing PC and just do everything on my MacBook and probably do it even better. Even more so because these MacBooks have professional grade color correct screens. It's essentially a shrunk down version of the $5,000 Pro Display XDR. Seriously, it would cost me about $3,000 to get a standalone non-Apple monitor with a similar quality. Now, even if you're not a video editor, the 14-inch M1 Pro just gives you a really high level of not only performance, but also portability and battery life compared to many other laptops on the market. Sure, you can get an absolute beast of a Windows PC, but don't forget they typically need to be attached to the charger to reach full performance. I actually uploaded a video yesterday where I put the 14-inch base model M1 Pro MacBook against the 2021 Razer Blade 14 with an RTX 3060. I'll link that in the top right hand corner, but the Razer does have more raw power, but at the cost of needing to be attached to a charger, which is absolutely massive, by the way. Its fans are really loud and it just has way less features. Now, moving on to cons, and guys, I really don't have anything really negative to say about these devices. They're really great, and I do recommend them for most people if you can afford the $2,000 price tag. But these things I'm about to talk about aren't necessarily cons, they're more so misconceptions or issues that surround these machines at this point in time. So first of all, let's talk about the thermal differences between the 14-inch MacBook and the 16-inch MacBook. Now, this is only an issue because on paper, they're both exactly the same, except for obviously the larger screen size and footprint on the 16-inch. So it makes sense that the performance between the two would be the exact same, right? Well, not quite, and this can be a bit of an unwelcome surprise to people who aren't aware. The 16 has larger fans and also has more surface area to cool the same M1 Pro chip. Now you're gonna see the biggest difference here if you're using the M1 Max chip. It's bigger, it runs hotter, it just produces more heat. But even with the smaller M1 Pro chip, I did notice that the 14-inch would run a little bit hotter, and you'd also have more fan noise compared to the 16-inch. And under the same load, oftentimes the fan on the 16-inch wouldn't even be spinning when the fan on the 14 would be. Now, that's not to say the fan on the 14 was obnoxiously loud, but it was definitely more loud than the 16-inch. Now, I think this is an important point to bring up because a lot of people just really hate fan noise. So just be aware if you are looking to pick up the 14-inch and maybe you're deciding against the 16-inch, for example. Now, let's talk about support for Apple Silicon. Now, take Blender, for example. It's a relatively popular program. Lots of people use it, but Metal GPU support is not supported on Apple Silicon for Blender. So what that means is if you have a really GPU heavy scene or render, your MacBook is just not gonna be able to compete anywhere near what a PC can, for example. So I tested this on the Razer Blade 14 with the RTX 3060, which is $200 cheaper, by the way, and it outperformed the base model M1 Pro 14-inch MacBook by a factor of 3 to 1. It was 3 times quicker to render the same Blender scene than the MacBook, and that is a massive difference. Also, tons of apps and games and programs still require Rosetta 2 in order to actually be able to run at all on Apple Silicon. And if you guys aren't familiar with Rosetta 2, it's essentially emulation software on macOS that emulates these apps and programs that aren't yet supported to actually run at all on Apple Silicon Macs. This means that even though you have this awesome, powerful computer, you're completely handicapped by badly optimized software. And guys, it is so frustrating because it's like having a sports car on a racetrack and there's a guy standing there waving a sign saying that you can't go above 30 miles per hour. It's just such a frustrating experience, especially for those of you who use like Blender and apps like that. Apple Silicon's been out for a year. It's really up to the developers at this point to sort it out. So hopefully those updates come sooner rather than later. Especially because I think with these new Macs and specifically the Apple Silicon Macs last year getting even more popular, it's kind of forcing developers to update all of their software. Anyway, guys, hopefully you enjoyed this brief recap of the last 7 days of using this machine. Honestly, it's been a really, really positive experience. Like I said before, I'm about to completely ditch my desktop beefy RTX 3080 Ryzen 3900X editing PC for one of these machines. I'm switching over my entire workflow to ProRes so that I can use Final Cut. That's how good these things are. So I'm really excited to see how the next couple months are gonna go. And I, of course, will keep you guys updated. But apart from that, thanks for watching this video and I will catch you in the next one.